Welcome everyone. So today I'm going to tell you a little bit about something called the quantum Kremer-Rau bound. Now I'm going to start by not pronouncing it correctly in the tradition of all good English speakers. From now on I'm just going to call it the Kremer-Rau bound. This is a fundamental bound that is a central result in all of quantum and classical metrology. So I'll start by telling you a little bit about metrology and why we're interested in this thing called metrology. So it's pretty much the most fundamental problem in physics and in engineering to detect and sense unknown parameters. So I'll give you some examples. So imagine you turn on your computer, there's a little sensor, or there's multiples, I think 12, 15 little sensors on the CPU of your computer, which just report the temperature of the CPU at any given point in time. So there's a parameter, it varies in time, and you want to estimate it. It's very important. If the CPU overheats, then it melts, and then you'll have to spend a couple of hundred euros to buy a new one. Another key parameter that you need to estimate on an everyday basis is, for example, the usage, the level of petroleum in the gas tank of your car. There's a parameter, you have to estimate it as time passes. And of course, you can think of endless more examples. The pressure in this room, the mass of a certain object as time passes. They're all parameters we want to estimate as time passes. So that this is the job of something called parameter estimation. We want to estimate one or more unknown parameters. And I'm going to discuss all of this in the context of quantum theory. I mean, there's a whole classical theory of this topic of parameter estimation. But I'm just going to jump over that and just go straight to the quantum estimation and parameter estimation theory because, you know, why not, right? It contains the classical theory as a subcase. So the goal of parameter estimation is you have your system and it's in some state. So this blob here is meant to represent state space. And you have some state, and that's the state of your system. And you want to estimate some parameter that's important to you, be it the temperature, pressure, or whatever. So the state of the system will, I mean, if the parameter is to be estimated at all, it better depend on that parameter in some way. So you have this state, it depends on the unknown parameter theta. And your goal is, what is theta? It's the fundamental goal of all of this. That's the task of parameter estimation. Tell us what theta is. Now, as an experimentalist, you can sense the system. You have sensors that you have built and engineered. And they amount to, in the context of this setting here, to measurements. So you're allowed to measure this state rho theta. So you can. So the way we're going to estimate theta is that, you know, sort of, I'll give you the first answer for how we could estimate theta, is we could just do full tomography. That would be one way to get out the value of theta. You know, you prepare your system, the state of the system depends on this unknown parameter, like the tension in a rod or something. You look at the system, you start measuring it, you need to do complete full tomography of the system state. And then that will give you, firstly, it gives you rho theta. And, well, one of the fundamental assumptions behind everything we're going to do here is that you know how theta depends, how rho depends on theta. So I should write that here, assumption. Otherwise, we're doing a different job altogether. So this is a fundamental assumption underlying everything we do. The state of the system depends on theta, and we know how it depends on theta. The only thing we don't know is theta. We just wish we knew theta. So answer one to how we could get theta is we could do full tomography. That would certainly give us the state. And then you could just invert the dependence of the state on theta to get you theta. So that's a perfectly decent way to estimate the unknown parameter theta. Except, of course, it's extraordinarily expensive. If, for example, you wanted to measure the tension or strain in a rod, doing a full tomography of all the 10 to the 23, the atomic state of all the 10 to the 23 atoms making up the rod would be a little bit excessive. Another problem with full tomography is that it's also slow, right? You know, because you're estimating very many variables to get the full state of the system, you're doing this very rapidly. You have to do this very rapidly if the parameter is to vary at all. So another reason why it's expensive is that theta varies with time, maybe slowly, but it still varies. And so the task of estimating this one unknown parameter or a handful of unknown parameters, full tomography is obviously not quite the right tool for this job. You want to develop better techniques that estimate theta, that are tuned to theta, this particular theta that you care about, rather than the degrees of freedom of all the unobservable degrees of freedom of all the states of all the atoms in a rod, for example. So there's a second way we can estimate the parameter, where we just focus on the one observable, this one value theta. So we could build an observable or build an apparatus to measure an observable A, which directly or more directly depends on this unknown parameter theta. And this would be kind of the minimal way you could do it. You could imagine building an apparatus, and the apparatus's task, the sensor task, is just to observe theta. And, well, you know, you want to minimize the work you do, so you build the sensor so that it's really good at measuring theta, but probably bad at measuring everything else. So let's define a little bit more clearly how we expect this observable to depend on theta, what sort of properties would a good observable have. Before I do that, I should have mentioned at the beginning where all this material is coming from. So I'm telling you about a proof that's provided in page 3 of a paper by Petz and Guinea on the quantum Fisher information. That's the objective today. So it's a long paper on the quantum Fisher information. Here it is here. It's some 20 pages long, I guess. And it's kind of a fairly comprehensive review of quantum metrology. And this is sort of the state of the art of the results around August 2010. So it's an excellent paper, but well, there's a lot of content in here, and just page 3 alone is sort of sufficiently deep that it'll occupy the next 40 minutes or so. So that's my objective, is just to explain page 3 of this paper. So in order to deal with this problem, what is theta, we're going to build an observable, and we're not just going to build any crazy observable, we're going to build an observable which is tuned to measuring theta and not particularly tuned to anything else. And the way we extract theta is we first compute the expectation value of our observable with respect to the state rho theta, and well, obviously, that expectation value, if we've designed our observable well, should depend on theta, right? It's almost tautological here. So this is the expectation value of the observable A is just trace of rho theta A. And then we get theta by just inverting F. You know, you estimate the expectation value by repeating some trials, and you get theta by inverting F on that expectation value. And if you've designed your observable well enough, then this inversion will be harder or easier and stable or less stable. But for the purposes of this talk, we're going to make some assumptions now about the properties of such an observable. So we're going to, I guess I'll put a line here. We're going to make some assumptions about how good this observable is. And I'm not going to really talk about whether the task of building this observable, that's quite a difficult problem by itself. I'm just going to say, suppose we have a sufficiently nice observable, what can we say then? That's the purpose of today. And the whole task of building the best observable for the job, that's another talk. All right, so we're going to call a locally unbiased estimator if it has a very nice property, namely that if you do the derivative with respect to theta of the expectation value of A near theta equals zero, and I'll say something about theta equals zero in a second, then it varies linearly with theta. So this is about the best, this is like the best case scenario for an estimator of this parameter here. So some more hidden assumptions. I'm going to add some hidden assumptions here, namely that theta is in some interval like this, around zero. That's a more or less a convenience assumption rather than a fundamental assumption. It's convenient to assume that the baseline value of theta is zero. So, you know, if nothing's sort of happening, if there's no strain in the rod, if the temperature of the room is stable, then you normalize that baseline value to zero. And in the case of the temperature in a room, I guess you might choose 24 degrees centigrade as the baseline value, and the actual parameter you're measuring is the difference of the temperature from 24 degrees. And in a case of a rod, you'd measure the strain relative to the no strain situation. Yeah, question?
Is that point for normalization randomly chosen, or can that be randomly chosen?
Is the point for normalization randomly chosen?
Can you just normalize?
You can insist on working around another value if you want, and everything I can say will be generalizable to that case. But to make things simple, we're going to assume that rho theta lives in this interval here. Oh, and of course, you know, epsilon is greater than zero. So you know the shortest ever mathematician joke, right? Right, so that's the assumption. A is a good observable if it satisfies this property that if you differentiate the expectation value near theta is zero, it's one. And so what that means is, of course, that the expectation value of A with respect to theta looks like this. It looks like theta plus something else. You know, unless you've chosen things to be completely absurd, it's going to be differentiable, and you can use a Taylor development to at least say that, right? So this is a good observable, right? It's as good as it can be. You estimate the expectation value, and you don't even have to do this bit. There's no need to invert F because theta is the expectation value. So then we've got this wonderful observable. Let's assume we can build it. And oftentimes you can. It takes a bit of work, but sometimes you can. Then you might wonder, well, like, how good is it? And now we have to talk about how goodness and badness. I just call it goodness and badness. Yep. Good question. Yeah. Is the system finite dimensional? It certainly is for this talk. I've got a trace, so there's obviously trace class states operators hanging around. Let's assume it's finite dimensional for this talk. There is a way to generalize things to infinite dimensions. Yeah, let's not go there. It's you know, this is already hard enough. Now, yeah, we want to assess now the goodness and badness of this estimator A. So the thing is, right, the expectation value, how do you get that in an experiment? Well, in the world of quantum mechanics, you have detectors and detectors go click, and then you build empirical averages. You repeat the trial many times. You know, I the last experiment that I was actually somehow peripherally involved with, they had it like a million times per second. They would repeat the experiment a million times per second and build empirical averages this way. And so the goodness and badness of an estimator like this is like how quickly, one way to assess the goodness and badness of an estimator, how quickly does an empirical average tend to theta? Because if it's fluctuating wildly, the each measurement of this observable A, then it will take a long time to settle down to theta. So this is, all I'm trying to do is just to say that the goodness and the badness of this estimator is determined by the variance of A. That's the second moment is really what tells you how quick things converge, how bad the fluctuations are around the average value. So that's the first quantity we should think about using to measure the goodness or badness of this observable A. And it is indeed this quantity that the Kramer-Rao bound is taking aim at. So let's say, what we're going to do is we focus. It's important to say that from now on, I'm just going to focus on theta equals zero and look at the variance around theta equals zero. And then everything I can say can be translated to arbitrary values of theta. So we focus on, in which case we write rho naught for rho evaluated at theta equals naught. I'll use that notation a lot. And our sort of the baseline, the task is that's our task. How low can we make this variance go? So in the space of all observables that estimate theta, all locally unbiased observables, how low is it possible to make that variance go? Obviously, the lower the better. And then we would definitely prefer the lower variance versus the higher variance estimators. And so the Kramer-Rao bound is a lower bound for this variance. It tells us you can't go any lower than some number. So I'll quote that. Yeah, how about I quote it in all its glory, and then I'll explain it in terms of an example, and then I hope I'll be able to prove it to you. It's an utterly straightforward proof, but it's sort of dressed up in a lot of super operator stuff. Now, I believe it's possible. Yeah, there you go. Good. So let me now quote the main result. So this is the quantum Kramer-Rao bound. And it reads that the variance around theta equals naught of an estimator A, which is, well, it's pretty easy to estimate that, right? Calculate the variance, because only the first term matters. The first term matters, right? Trace of rho A squared is the first part of the variance, and the second part is zero, because at theta equals zero, the estimator is zero. This, you can't get it any lower than a special number. And this special number depends on the state rho naught in the observable A. And what is this special number? Well, it's a very special quantity called the quantum, or just the Fisher information. And I'll write out how it's defined here, and we'll spend a little time understanding the formula. Yeah, I'll write it out in a full, somewhat scary looking way. Definitely scary looking way. Okay, you won't usually see the quantum Fisher information written out in this peculiar fashion, but I'm going to force you through this notation because it's useful for the proof later on. Now, I haven't told you what omega is. I think delta theta of rho at theta equals naught is clear. And so I just have to tell you, what is this crazy omega thing? And then once we know that, then we should be on our way. So here it is. Okay, I guess you've had enough time to look at that board, so it can go. So omega is a thing called a super operator. And it has the following properties. I'll say what a super operator is in slightly more detail in a second. So omega rho naught is something that eats an operator and gives you back an operator. So that's why we call it a super operator. And here is the super operator in question, the one that we use for the quantum Fisher information. It's a half time. If you input an operator x, then it outputs an operator x, and that operator omega rho x, and that operator is defined by a half multiply on the left by rho naught plus a half multiply on the right by rho naught. So omega rho naught is a map from the operators of our system. And since our system will be finite dimensional, we're going to have an n dimensional quantum system. It's a linear map from Mn, the observables of our quantum system, to the observables of our quantum system. It's a funny looking thing. I will fully grant that it's not something you would immediately write down. It does not have any motivation at this point, except that it appears as a lower bound for something that we really care about, namely the variance here. Now, it's sort of traditional in most discussions of the quantum Fisher information to have some kind of assumption on how rho depends on theta. So before we prove this statement, I'm going to go ahead and prove this today. I'm going to first make an assumption on how does rho depend on theta. So rho can depend on theta in many, many, many ways, right? And the way we're going to assume that rho depends on theta in this talk is as a unitary rotation of some kind of fiducial state. You don't have to do this, but it's very, yep, question?
Why do you write a dependence on A in the Fisher information? Is there any dependence on A?
Why do I write the dependence on A in the Fisher information? That's a good question.
So the way it's written, there is no dependence.
The way it's written, there is actually no dependence of A on the Fisher information here. That's correct. The way it appears is somewhat indirect. So first we make an assumption on how does rho vary with theta, and then we tune, and then remember that, so rho depends on theta, right? And theta is the thing you want to estimate. And A is the locally unbiased estimator for this value. And the way rho depends on theta determines how good the variance is of our our estimator A here. So in some sense, I could have just erased A and put theta in there, but I didn't want to do that in that I wanted you to have the estimator still in the expression. It's true for all observables. Yeah, I should have said that, right? That's just the nicer way to say it. Yeah, this is, no matter what locally unbiased estimator you choose, this will be true.
So yeah.
The F does not in that sense depend on A. Sorry. Okay, yeah, now I see why everyone was confused. X. Sorry, that's my fault. Where? Yeah. 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 This is. There's always two operators playing in a parameter estimation problem. There's the operators which say how the state depends on theta, and then there's the operators which tell you what theta is. And I got them confused. Yep.
Another question. In the middle of your expression for Fisher information, big capital omega is acting on omega to the minus.
Yeah. So what's going on with that? Yeah. So omega acts on omega minus one. So actually they cancel.
Okay.
I'm leaving that in there for convenience later on in the proof. There's a simpler way to write this quantity by canceling these omegas like that. Good. So usually we're gonna we take rho to depend on theta in a particular way, and here's the way it depends on theta here. You don't need to assume this. That's just one way to go on with this discussion. This is the typical assumption because it occurs in many, many experiments and realistic scenarios. I guess I'll draw this picture. I mean, it's impossible to have a discussion of parameter estimation without drawing this picture at least once. So we put in the vacuum, we put in some probe state here. We have some phase shift occurring here. And at the output of this interferometer, there's some quantum state of light, and everyone here needs to be able to draw this picture. If you come from Hanover, you have at least some indirect connection to gravitational wave astronomy, and this is, of course, the way we're detecting gravitational waves at the moment with interferometers. So this is the kind of rho of theta in this example here depends in some slightly convoluted way on theta in a fashion like this. That's why we're making that assumption. I think I have to erase the board now. One moment. So rho depends on theta. We want to know what theta is, how low can we go with the variance. Another unknown parameter that you could want to measure is the temperature, in which case rho would depend on theta in a different way. Rho of theta would be the exponential of minus theta times the Hamiltonian. This formula can also cope with that scenario as well, but let's leave it at this for the moment. If we assume that rho of theta depends on theta like that, and also we have our working assumption that theta is pretty small anyway, because if we're looking at big changes, then, well, we can notice them quicker. It's only small changes that are really hard to notice. Then we can look at things to first order. And we know that rho theta must vary with theta according to this formula here. And that immediately tells us what d theta rho at theta equals zero is. It's in fact minus I x commutator, row naught. And so that formula there is what we're going to stick up in there into this Fisher information quantity. And then we will, in this case, get a nice formula for f of rho naught x. So first step is to cancel off these omegas, which are hanging around. And then I guess, well, in my notes, I've written down all the steps of the derivation. But you know what? I'm going to leave this as an exercise for the reader. It's a nice little exercise. I'll explain all the symbols. I just won't derive it. So the way we calculate this quantity here is from this somewhat terrifying looking expression here. Is we go to the eigenbases of rho naught. That's the way to get forward. So rho naught can be written in terms of its eigenbases. So here we're going to make a fundamental assumption that all of these coefficients here are greater than zero. So that's important to notice. Otherwise, you have to deal with partial inverses. And there are some subtleties to do with defining the quantum Fisher information for boundaries of the set of mixed states. So we'll be a little bit, we're going to avoid that just by assuming that our state is always full rank. And our operator x, we express our operator x in the eigenbases of rho naught just by the completeness relation two times. So if you go through, take this diagonal rho naught, and you express x in the basis of rho naught, and you substitute this into that horrible looking expression for the Fisher information up here, then I claim after some dust settling and some, it took me 4 or 5 lines, you will end up with this expression for the Fisher information. Okay, so it's a crazy looking quantity. I don't expect this to be intuitive. But it's quite a magical quantity. It's got lots of very nice properties. I will not tell you any of them today, but instead focus on deriving this bound up here, which is what justifies the Fisher information as being an interesting thing in the first place. And I should say that this bound is tight for one parameter estimation problems. If you want to estimate two or more parameters, there is a similar bound. It's basically the same proof, but it's not known to be tight in general, the bound that you get. In fact, it's known to be not tight in some examples. All right, so let's go ahead and prove it. I love this proof, so I'm going to sacrifice examples for the sake of the proof. I think it's super clever. The way the proof works is we're going to use the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. That's the proof. Okay, so I've told you the proof. Of course, the art of the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality proof is finding out how to express the thing you want to bound as an inner product. And that's what we're going to do now. We're going to build a very carefully tuned inner product that'll allow us to deploy the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality and just give us that inequality straight out. And so the way we do it is according to the following definition. So we're going to build the following inner product on operators. So this is a sesquilinear functional on the space of observables. You've got to think a bit to convince yourself it's an inner product. Is it sesquilinear? Well, you need to substitute in omega rho naught and then do a little calculation. What are the other properties an inner product has to satisfy? It has to be positive, right? It has to be A comma A has to always be greater than equal zero. Again, it's a small verification. Put in this omega here and check that whenever B equals A, this is greater than zero. That also follows from the full rankedness of rho. And what's the other one? What do we need for an inner product? Symmetry. Yeah, that follows from cyclic rule of trace. Ah, what's omega? The question is, what's omega inverse? Well, omega is a linear operator. So omega inverse is the inverse of as a linear operator.
But then you have omega and omega inverse.
Up here?
Yes.
Yeah, they cancel.
So why have I written
omega and omega inverse there? Because the proof will eventually hand us that expression, and I want to connect the end of the proof to that thing there.
So
it's redundant. I shouldn't. I didn't have to do that. What? So the statement was, if I have a state that's proportional to the identity,
yes.
Rho naught is proportional to the identity,
yes.
Then omega inverse is well defined, yes?
Yeah, and this thing should be infinite.
Why should it be infinite?
Because from the statement of the theorem on the left, the variance should be zero.
Why is the variance zero if the state is the identity?
Because it doesn't
trace of a squared is not zero, right?
Is it variance? Is it trace rho a squared minus trace rho a squared, or is it just trace rho a squared? I mean, you have.
For a locally unbiased estimator, trace of a is zero. But trace of a squared is not zero, right? It's a positive operator, so, or at least a positive semi-definite operator. So there's no reason that trace of a squared should be zero. The variance can be non-zero if the expectation value is zero. So this makes sense for rho as the identity and is not infinity. Good. So we build this inner product. I mean, this is the reason I love this proof is sort of the cunningness with which this inner product is built. And let's notice some things about this inner product that we really like. I claimed that it was positive. Well, let's convince ourselves it's positive by simply putting in A twice. And we get this result here. For A is Hermitian. Let's assume A is Hermitian, otherwise, it's not quite as easy. So then, but this is exactly the variance that we wanted to estimate. It's kind of a good sign, right? You know, we've got an inner product such that when you input an operator twice and it's Hermitian, then it actually is equal to the variance with respect to rho naught. And now we can also note something else, further evidence that this is a very good quantity to look at. What if we put in the identity as the second argument? I should have written that, I'm sorry. This equality here is only true in the case that A is locally unbiased. If A is not locally unbiased, then, well, it's just not the variance. Something else. Okay, but this thing here, this is something we can look at, and this has a very nice. Value, it's the expectation value of A. Now I'm going to do something slightly perverse. No, not yet. I'll do the perverse thing on a new board. Not enough space to do it here.
Sorry?
Yep. It's defined for all operators.
But this node also needs hermeticity, right?
But if you want this to be true here, you need hermeticity.
The second step.
This step here needs hermeticity? Yes, that also needs hermeticity. Ugh. Yeah.
So, but we don't assume hermeticity in.
We don't need to assume hermeticity throughout, no. Now, time for some perversity. I'm going to choose a very complicated way to write the number one. Okay, if A is locally unbiased, then the expectation value of A is proportional to theta. And if I differentiate that, then I get the number one, and if I evaluate it at theta equals zero. Okay, so that's sort of already. A little bit perverse, but it gets better, right? We know how to write the expectation value of A in terms of the trace of A times rho naught of rho. Of course, you know, in general, rho is going to depend on theta. Okay, it's implicit that theta, that there's some theta dependence in here, right? I haven't evaluated that rho naught, theta is naught until I've differentiated. Okay, the next step, I've used the fact that this is actually true for all theta. So I've differentiated the expectation value of A, which I know happens to be equal to this thing here, which I know I can write rho of theta as omega rho of theta of the identity. So it's a yet more complicated way to write it. And let's get even more complicated. I'm going to insert the identity. Like that. So I can always multiply by the inverse of the super operator and then multiply by the super operator. That's, you can do that, right? If you want to do that, you can do that. And I'm going to call this thing in here L. Now, why did I do all this crazy stuff? Well, so that I can write the right-hand side like this. And now, the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality should start to appear to be a logical thing to do. So of course, 1 equals this. So the absolute value of 1 is 1. And then, why not deploy the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality? And that's what it tells us. And at this point, we're almost done. So we now recognize things that we like. We recognize this object here. Remember how I argued that when you input a Hermitian locally unbiased estimator inside this inner product, that's none other than the variance. And this thing here, well, we don't know what to do with that yet. And we've got 1. So we've got that the variance times something is bigger than 1. And another way of rewriting that is that the variance is bigger than 1 on this thing. And that thing is none other than the quantum Fisher information. So if we look at the definition of L here, you'll see why I insisted on this peculiar way of writing the Fisher information. And that's the end of the proof. So that's, I hope, a justification for why the quantum Fisher information is an interesting thing, and why we are fascinated with this peculiar object here, these inner products. Yeah, a question?
So this derivation still only works for Hermitian operators, right?
This derivation only works for Hermitian operators.
So otherwise you don't get the variance.
You don't get the variance, that's right, yeah. In fact, it only works for locally unbiased estimators.
But they're not naturally Hermitian, are they?
Locally unbiased estimators are per definition observables, so they're Hermitian, and yes. I mean, there's some extent which you can fiddle with this proof a bit and make it work for non-Hermitian objects, but like then the operational interpretation is a little bit sort of questionable. Yeah, a question?
So what about POVMs?
What about POVMs?
They're not observables,
yeah. So I actually don't know the state of the art with POVMs and parameter estimation.
So classically, there shouldn't be a difference.
There's definitely not a difference classically. Quantumly, I don't know how to answer that question. Whether or not you could sort of beat this with a POVM. Well, I can't see at this point immediately if I've derived a statement that would apply directly to POVMs or not. I mean, you'd have to come up with a notion of a locally unbiased PVM, POVM, sorry.
Well, we can do that.
We can do that.
By the first and second model.
Yeah, okay, so actually, you know, future work, or at least literature search, right? That's something to do. I'm not an expert in the quantum Fisher information, so it could well be this is well understood and I don't know the answer. And so there's things, some other comments to make, you know, before I finish. This whole proof technique extends easily, I think even the word easily is appropriate here, to multiple parameters. That's a good question. Okay, I didn't define. What do I mean, multiple parameters? So if rho now depends on not one, but m parameters like this, and our job is to estimate all m parameters. I mean, that's something that could happen quite easily, right? You want to measure the pressure and temperature and volume of a gas or something. It's three parameters. Then the thing that, and then you set up nice estimators for these three parameters or these m parameters here. You want an estimator for each parameter, individually, yeah. And then the quantity, and then you can set up a locally unbiased estimator for each of these parameters here. And then the fundamental thing which limits how precise you can do things is no longer the variance, but in fact the covariance of these estimators. So that's a matrix, the covariance of these, an M by M matrix. And there is indeed it's a positive semi-definite matrix, actually, the covariance matrix. And it's a concave function of its argument, which is very interesting, of the state, that is. And there is an exact analog of the Kramer-Rao bound for this multi-parameter estimation case as well. So there's a Fisher information quantity, which we will call JK, depending on rho naught and some bunch of operators that tell how rho naught depends on these parameters. The problem here is that it's no longer possible to saturate this inequality in general. Another question?
Yeah, so these estimators, should they commute or?
You ask good questions. So do these estimators commute? Not in general. How do you measure them? Well, I mean, you measure them individually, right? And you look at the covariance of the statistics, the empirically determined statistics after the fact. It's not required the joint measurement of those estimators. But I believe it's true that if you have two parameters and you can jointly measure the observables, then you can saturate this inequality. Yes, I guess so. You could think of a superparameter. Yeah, so that's one comment here. Another thing it's worth commenting on, the quantum Fisher information is now an active topic of study in itself. It's a remarkable quantity. You can investigate its properties. So the Fisher information turns out is a convex function of its argument. That's super not obvious. You could ask, by understanding this quantum Fisher information, maybe I could connect things, statements about parameter estimation with quantum coherence, with entanglement and correlations. These are all topics of active research right now. And one result I particularly like is asking whether or not the Fisher information itself has an operational meaning. And it turns out it does. And that's a topic definitely for another talk, but it's a very remarkable result indeed due to, I'll just put the authors. I'll mention this paper again in the future. There's just about any question you can ask is an interesting question, especially in this multi-parameter case here. Yeah, another one?
So initially we had this assumption of theta coming from this epsilon region.
Yes. Oh, what happens if we relax the epsilon region?
So we didn't use the epsilon. Right?
We didn't actually use the fact, that's
so
right. Exactly. So it certainly, and then maybe another way to rephrase your question, if theta is allowed to not vary in some small open set, but in some bigger set, then we lose a lot of our assumptions about the Taylor expansion and so on. So it's not as clear then that things are analytic as functions of theta.
So is there any hidden assumption on compactness of this interval or something like that?
Not that I'm aware of. Another question?
What kind of interval do you choose, or intervals do you choose if you have more than one parameter?
So what intervals do we choose if we have multiple parameters? I guess as long as it's a small open set centered on zero, at least that argument works. All theta have to lie in some open set around some fixed point, I would guess. Certainly for that proof to work, that would be sufficient, but I mean, probably relax that. In this whole argument, this parameter was necessarily one-dimensional, yes. There is a generalization to multi-dimensional parameters, if you like, via the quantum Fisher information matrix, this thing here. I guess you could say, what if theta wasn't a continuous parameter but some discrete set of values? I don't know the answer. I guess you'd have to just do unambiguous state discrimination or something instead. There's lots of ways to change the question, so I guess that's why it's also an interesting thing to look at, right? Because you can ask simple questions and get quite interesting answers. So I think my time is up, and yeah, thank you very much.